Okay, we're gonna plug in the sound. We are live.
Oh, great.
One second. Twist this. Hi, guys. Tighten this guy up.
He has gazillion followers, so he likes to live stream his work, which makes good sense.
Well, I want to make sure that we can, all right. I think we're good. Are we here? Hi, this is Heather.
Heather Joseph with him. Okay, so the reason I've asked Father Sebastian to come here, and by the way, it's really nice that he did, because as of this morning, he was in New York, and 3 days ago, he was in Florida.
So I was?
You were not?
I was.
You were. He's always traveling. He's sort of an international vampire, even though he lives here. He's not here all that often, apparently. He's all over the place promoting, well, not necessarily promoting vampirism. I'll let him tell you what it is he's promoting. I think he is the best-known vampire in all the world at the moment. In some ways, he is representative of vampire subcultures. In other ways, he's a very idiosyncratic individual who does totally his own thing, although that is very vampiric, really. You can't really be that much of a follower if you're going to be a vampire. You have to be sort of unique. And I think he's also, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, but he's the only person that I've ever heard of who's managing to make a living, and a very good one, out of being a vampire. And that's kind of an incredible thing. So in some ways, his life is performance art. So he's got some very interesting things going on. He's also a published author. He's written books about contemporary vampirism. He lectures, and he owns a club called The Endless Nights that can be found in LA or New Orleans or Paris. Is it London yet? So it's all over the place. So it's pretty crazy, and it's pretty interesting. So he is very sort of postmodern vampire, I guess you could say. So please welcome Father Sebastian. Thank you.
Hi, everybody. As Heather said, I'm Father Sebastian. There's no priestly title. It just means dad of the vampire community. For me, the vampire has been a major icon in my life. It has transformed me and metamorphosized my experience in life, and I'm not obsessed, but I am in love and I have a passion for what the vampire represents in my life, and I'd like to share that with the world. So one of the things that the vampire represents to me is basically that perfect evolution of the human consciousness. Something just above us, just something a little bit beyond our imagination. The vampire's mythology has been with us in probably every single human culture since the beginning of humanity. So if you are from Asia, or you're from Russia, or you're from Africa, or you're from Native American, or you're European, there is some vampire myth in every single culture. Okay, so who here would consider themselves a fan of the vampire genre? Raise your hand. Okay, who here is hardcore? Okay, Heather, obviously. The vampire is also one of the most diverse mythologies. It is romantic, it's monstrous, it's evil, it's good. And the modern vampire mythology has its origins back in ancient Sumeria. And there was the Lilitu and the origins of Lilith from the Zohar, which was actually a 15th century, 14th century Hebrew legend about Adam's first wife, which was before Eve. And she got cast out of the Garden of Eden because she liked to be on top. Okay, she's symbolic of the ultimate feminist. So what's very cool about the vampire mythology is it doesn't discriminate by race, it doesn't discriminate by gender, it does not discriminate by almost anything, because anybody can become a vampire. That's the actual magic of the mythology. You can be transformed and become this creature that is more than human, but very close to human. It still has the human mind. And in different mythologies, it's kind of trapped in Anne Rice's novels, while other stories of vampires and evolution from the human psyche, the ultimate predator, hiding in plain sight, a wolf in sheep's clothing. Okay, so the origins of the vampire mythology are a as old as human civilization. If we go back to ancient Sumeria about 8,000 years ago, 9,000 years ago, 10,000 years ago, what you'll see is you'll see these legends and myths paralleling human culture. For example, you have different witches and different kinds of sorcerers that would, when upon death, they would become a vampiric creature. But in all, what does the word vampire mean? It means to take life force from another person to benefit yourself. Okay, so there is the predator aspect of the vampire. The vampire is the ultimate predator because it hunts amongst humans on the top of the food chain. Okay, now if we go back to most of the ancient vampire myths, the revenant is the most common, like in the Slavic countries and the ancient countries of Eastern Europe. And the revenant is actually a bloated zombie that drinks the blood that comes out to hunt their family members. Have you ever seen the TV show The Strain? Has anybody seen The Strain? One of my favorite shows, because vampirism is like an evolutionary disease. Okay, it's these little worms that embed into your body, and then there's seven masters. I think there's seven or nine masters. And the mythology basically says that vampirism is spread as a virus. That's one interpretation of the vampire mythology. Okay. Another interpretation of the vampire mythology is that it's a curse from God. Okay. Another interpretation is that there is no curse. It might be an alien creature, okay, that comes to Earth, or a soul that has a second, that vampire has a second soul. So the origins of vampirism come with mythology. Okay. And has anybody read The Power of Myth by Joseph Campbell? Okay. Millennials, read this book. It's awesome because he consulted for George Lucas, if you're a Star Wars fan. Okay? And what's really cool about The Power of Myth is it shows you how mythology has been a very, very important element of our culture. You can get the lectures on Audible or probably on YouTube if you'd like. Okay, The Power of Myth is an incredible, incredible book. Okay, I've read it several times, and it shows how mythology has evolved into what we know today as religion. Okay, the vampire mythology, since it's been with us for the majority of our life, our human culture, okay, has impacted us in a very interesting way, and until today, has evolved a modern way, Western mythology. What is that mythology? And it began, all right, with Mary Shelley and a guy named Polidori back in the 1800s, and then he wrote a poem, basically a short story slash poem called The Vampire with a Y. And that was the first modern vampire myth, okay, before we had the revenants and the old creatures. And Mary Shelley was also there, okay, and guess what she wrote? Does anybody know? Frankenstein, exactly. So over the years, the vampire mythology has evolved. In fact, has anybody seen Interview with the Vampire? Okay. I just did some research, and I found out there was 4 real vampire theaters in Paris between 1820 and 1850. They were not real vampires, but what they were theaters doing vampire plays. Okay? 4 of them over a different period of time. Then Varney the Vampire came out, which was kind of our first version of Dracula. Carmilla, okay, is another one. Then we evolved into 1896, a very important date in vampire history. Does anybody know what this is? Dracula was published by Bram Stoker. Now, what that represented was, it represented the modern beginning of really, truly the modern vampire mythology, where a vampire was cursed, he was from the Eastern countries, and he was invading the civilized British Isles. The British Empire was challenged because at that time Slavic people were moving in troves into London, and there was a fear of disease. It was representing that Dracula was a disease coming on the Demeter through the Mediterranean, making his way up to coming to London, which he landed, okay, in outside of London, okay, and at a village called Whitby. Actually, can I get that stool?
Yeah.
Check if I can see.
see me in the camera while I'm sitting down? Cool. So England has its vampire mythology. One thing about mythology in England is that England has King Arthur. England has Britain has these old myths and legends. But what's very interesting about the UK is that modern mythology, like for example, Tolkien, J.R.R. Tolkien, wrote Lord of the Rings as a mythology because there wasn't a lot of mythologies in the UK. For example, in Ireland, they had all the fairies and the kings and everything like that. And in England and Scotland, there wasn't a lot of mythology. So J.R.R. Tolkien wrote basically Lord of the Rings. Another mythology that came from the vampire mythology was most influenced by an Irishman, okay, about London, and that was Dracula. Okay, today in London you have a very interesting vampire subculture because you have a bar called Garlic and Shots where you can go and have garlic shots. It's run by these two Swedish people. They have a coffin basement. It's really cool. There's a vampire ball run by an organization called Club Antichrist, which is rock and roll vampire. There's a vampire London vampire meetup once a month on Thursdays, and that is basically under the shadow of Bram Stoker's Dracula. Okay, so when you look at London, it's truly a vampire city. Okay, and I really love the fact that Harry Potter's aesthetic kind of evolved out of that, very related to that. And when I look at Harry Potter, I really think of Bram Stoker's Dracula. Now, when we talk about mythology, we need to be aware that mythology is something that is tangible, but not tangible. It affects our lives, but is not affecting us in a physical way. It affects us in a psychological way. And we respond to that and interact with that. And today, what I'm really excited about is mythology is making a huge comeback. If you go to Comic-Con and you see all these people cosplaying all these characters from Japan, a lot of these mythologies that they use for the mangas and the cosplay, like, you know, Vampire Knight and Castlevania, are vampire cosplay is very popular, but the mythology is interacting with us. We're making it tangible because we love it. But we know that what's great about mythology, we know it's a myth. It's not an all-consuming reality. Like, for example, people ask me every day, do vampires exist? And I'm like, well, let me take an opinion here. Raise your hand if you think vampires really exist. You do? And what would a vampire be in reality?
I don't know. I mean, I don't think it's going to look like a stereotypical, Dracula, Bigfoot, Peak, but I'm sure there's... I mean, I don't know.
Okay. Yeah. Just throwing out that you believe in vampires?
I believe in Bigfoot, too, so it's
For real?
Yeah, I do.
Really? Have you seen him?
I haven't seen him, but I hope I don't. But...
Bigfoot?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's cool. So, Bigfoot, I mean, that's like something that, you know, cryptozoology, which is a really fun subject, is the exploration of crypto, you know, when you look into these, you know, Loch Ness Monster or Bigfoot or, you know, weird creatures in the Amazon or dinosaurs in lakes and stuff like that. What's interesting is those are legends, okay? And what the vampire mythology is really interesting because I went to Romania last year and I met a vampire called Andrea Bathory. Okay, and if you know Elizabeth Bathory, you know, he took the name from there. But it was a really interesting experience because I went to walk in the footsteps of Dracula. I wanted to go see Vlad Tepes' locations and ritual places where the Order of Dracul met and everything. And what happened was I didn't believe he was a real person. I thought it was a fake book character. Okay, it's a Facebook character that. So I call him up on the Facebook Messenger and I'm like, hello. And he goes, hello. And I'm like, oh, come on. That's not your real voice. He goes, what do you want? I'm Romanian. And I was like, okay. And then I got on a plane and I realized he was real and I went to the airport and I was waiting, drinking a coffee. And lo and behold, a vampire showed up in Romania with long claws. Yes. And sunglasses. And speaking with a Romanian accent. And he took me all over Romania. I got to go to where Dracula was beheaded. I got to go to two of the palaces, Bram Castle,
I got to experience. We went ghost hunting. We went spirit hunting. We went to. We drove into. Like I thought he was going to kill me at first. And we drove up to this mountain. I forget the name of it, but it was with a cable car, and everything had looked like it had a layer of dust over it. It was a really interesting adventure. And when I went up on the cable car, he was like, you know, up here is where the Order Dracul would meet, which is the Order of the Dragon, which was designed by the Christian knights to fight the Turks that were trying to invade Christianity, the Christian kingdoms, Christendom. And what happened was we got to the top of the hill and the energy was insane. But the night before, we drove into the village at 2 a.m. looking for a hotel room without a booking. I'm like, just let me go on booking.com, I'll book a hotel. He's like, no, we must find the right place. And I'm like, I spent a week with this guy with this accent. We had a great time. And yes, it was quite an interesting experience. I want to go back to Romania so bad, but my schedule hasn't permitted it. Now, if we want to look at locations for vampires, who here, let's throw out some words. Which place in the world do you think is most associated with vampires?
Hollywood.
Okay. Anyone else? Like when you think of a city?
It's New Orleans.
Okay. New Orleans. Anyone else? Has anybody been to New Orleans? Did you like it?
Yes.
Did you, were you able to imbibe the drinks, or you're not a bit into?
No, I was like 10 when I went, so definitely not.
Oh, okay, never mind. So we have Romania, we have London. Another city which was for a long time the capital of the vampires was New York City. Okay, not by mythology, but because what happened was, is there was a vampire subculture that existed there in the 1990s. When I came in to make fangs, I'm a fangsmith. That's my primary job. I make people vampire teeth. I'm a dental technician. That's how I got into the vampire scene. And I basically, when I came into this vampire subculture, there was a Tony Sokol's Vampire Theater, which was a vampire, La Comédie de Sanguine. And then there was the Vampire the Masquerade Games. And then there was a lifestyle vampire community. You'd walk through the East Village, and I remember meeting these people who lived a vampire lifestyle. They didn't even try to do it. They just did it. There was a couple named Ace and Ethan, which were side vampires. And Ace did a lot of acid back in the 60s. But he was energetic vampire, so he would take your life force. Okay, and Ethan was his, you know, Ace was in his 60s. He was very silver. And Ethan was his boyfriend at 22 years old. And he was like a rocker dude. They lived up in this 8-story building. I also met Vlad and Sky. Vlad looks like Dracula from Bram Stoker's Dracula, and his girlfriend is this beautiful, petite Asian goddess that does not age. And they are a very pagan vampire. Okay, I remember this guy, Christian, who was dating a woman named Susan Walsh. Okay, and Christian, I met him a couple times, and he always wore a Victorian jacket, a real one. And you could see it was kind of worn. It was beautiful. And these people are just some examples. And I remember when I met my first vampire, a guy named Michael. Okay, he had long, long hair and a trench coat and a cane. And he was the first vampire I met in New York. And that was before I became a fangsmith. I was investigating the vampires. Then in 1996, a major event happened. A woman named Susan Walsh was investigating the vampire covens of the East Village. And she disappeared at my vampire. This was the second vampire ball that I threw, and it was in July of 1996. And according to people that had attended that vampire ball, a nightclub called Limelight. Has anybody seen the movie Party Monster? Okay. It's Macaulay Culkin and Seth Green. It's about a murder in a nightclub. That club is where I started my career in vampirism. Okay. It's called the Limelight. And after Michael Alec murdered one of his fellow club promoters, I became the manager of the club for about 6 months, and I threw a vampire ball. And supposedly, people saw Susan Walsh the last time at that vampire ball. And that was in July of 1996. So before me, there was the Vampire the Masquerade of the Role Playing, which I'll get into in a minute, in New York. There was the, basically the old school vampire covens of the East Village,
And blood drinking was the official way of being a vampire, because you divide vampires into psychic and sanguine. You have a psychic vampire, which is an energy vampire, and a sanguine vampire, who actually is a person who drinks physical human blood, and they believe they need it to survive. I'll get into that in a little bit. But what happened was, when Susan Walsh disappeared, I was, I think, 22, and the media came down on us, okay? I got to be on MTV, I was in InStyle magazine, Glamour, Cosmopolitan, InStyle magazine, I was in the New York Times, and I was being interviewed about this woman who disappeared, and then one day, right after that disappearance, Anne Rice's biographer, Catherine Ramsland, came and wrote a book with me called Piercing the Darkness. Okay. And that was for about 98. I opened a nightclub called Long Black Veil, and it was a BDSM vampire Victorian nightclub. And it was a lot of fun because we had a coffin, and while you walk by the coffin, a different thing would happen every day, or every night in the coffin. Someone was smoking a joint, you'd have six goths laying. For Christmas, we actually had a picture of six vampires sitting next to each other in the coffin, hanging out. People would make out, they would get kinky in there. And Long Black Veil was a very weird club because it was very classy, but very much kinky at the same time. So from that club came a kind of a philosophy called the Black Veils, which is basically the lifestyle vampire community's culture. Each black veil is a word of power that goes along with it. And I'm about to release the book, Black Veils, the first time it's all compiled together this spring publicly. So you can actually go through and have a lexicon of the different vampire terminologies applied to real life. And the Black Veils have come in many forms. There was a 5-set, a 13-set, but I'm going to be releasing 140 of them, plus a history of the vampire culture. So New York was the center point of the vampire culture. Then something happened in 98. Blade came out. Has anybody seen Blade? Okay. And in Harlem, an interesting phenomenon happened. What I did was I created a business plan where if I made you fangs and then you made Autumn Fang, you referred Autumn, I put a family tree together. Okay, so it'd be like a lineage of sorts. And I call my fan clients the Sabertooths. So what happened was, is when Blade came out, I opened the door to Long Black Veil one night, and I saw a guy sitting there like this, across the street, dressed as Blade, but a perfect cosplay. And I'm like, I walk up to him and I go, dude, what's your deal? You gonna hunt us? I mean, we'd have people show up with garlic and crossbows and stuff like that as kind of to mock us and have fun. It was really cool. But we would actually welcome them in and buy them drinks. But what happened was, he goes, my name is Xanatos. And I'm like, all right, why don't you come in and have a drink? Okay, he's like, all right. And he comes in. But Xanatos was unique because he went up to Harlem. He lived in Harlem. And within 2 years, there was a new clan called Hidden Shadows and a nightclub called Hidden Shadows. 800 kids from the inner city would gather in this martial arts dojo and have a vampire party 10 times a year. And it lasted for 8 years. Imagine being a kid, a white kid from Ohio, walking into a club full of black vampires with teeth and contact lenses in, listening to Metallica and Rammstein. Okay, that happened 10 times a year in New York City, up in Harlem on 123rd Street in Lexington. It was awesome. I mean, the dance floor was like a trampoline. And the DJs were epic. The main DJ was a guy named Lestat. And he was actually born as Lestat.
Really?
Before Anne Rice wrote her book, Interview with the Vampire. And he was one of the best DJs. And he had long, he was a big black guy, giant, but a gentle giant, with long dreadlocks. And he would be in there DJing with the glasses from Blade. And they formed probably about 100 clans of vampires. It went viral in New York. And this Ankh that I have was designed as my company logo. And you go to New York, I walk into the Halloween store, which is the center of everything, and people will show off their Ankhs. There's over 100 variations of this made of sterling silver. These different clans of vampires in the inner city form different groups. Okay, you have Hidden Shadows, you have Pantheon, you have several nightclubs, you have tattoo parlors for vampires, but it's all black and Hispanic people. And it's really, really interesting how that is an example of how the mythology of the vampire has evolved beyond anything that I've really seen before.
Now, New Orleans, since Autumn is our New Orleans expert. New Orleans is probably the most legendary vampire city right now, okay? Because Anne Rice was there. You had, you know, the witches, the Mayfair witches, and you also have the, has anybody seen the originals? Raise your hand if you like the originals. Okay. You like it?
Yeah.
I haven't seen it.
That's good.
What's that?
It's pretty good.
Yeah? Is it as good as Vampire Diaries?
I think it's better.
More mature?
Like the storyline is better.
Okay. Is that where there's like a werewolf vampire hybrid?
Yeah.
Okay. So, one of the things that's very interesting about New Orleans is Anne Rice was, after Bram Stoker, was one of the most important and prolific vampire writers in history. Okay. She made the vampire angelic and cursed, but an atheist, until she got to her fifth book, Memnon the Devil. The Vampire Chronicles began in the 70s. I think the first Vampire Chronicle was written and released in 1975 or 1976, Interview with the Vampire. Then she released The Vampire Lestat and then Queen of the Damned. And it, has anybody seen a cosplay of Akasha, the Queen of the Vampires? Okay. In the movie, she was played by Aaliyah, okay? But in the book, she's actually Persian. She married Ankel, the king of Egypt, the pharaoh of Egypt. Okay, and she got cut, and a spirit went in her and made her the first vampire, and everybody was connected to her in a lineage. So she was very much a Lilith-type creature, okay? Now, what's very important to realize that Egyptian mythology only crossed over with vampires, really, with Anne Rice. There was no real mythology of vampires in ancient Egypt, okay? So when we look at New Orleans, Anne Rice's capital of the vampires, the American haven of vampires is New Orleans because it's a European city, it's old, and it's got three main vampire legends, okay? There's the Count Saint-Germain, there's the Carter brothers, and the Ursuline Convent and the Casket Girls. I encourage you to go down to New Orleans and take one of the vampire tours, and you'll be able to go and see the locations where Interview with the Vampire was filmed and these three different legends happened. New Orleans truly is the capital of vampire legends in the United States. It's eerie, it's dark, it's mysterious, and it's beautiful. And the reason is it's a European city inside the United States, but it's also a place of death and plague and murder and drunk people everywhere. And New Orleans is very much a city that has been through a lot, and that spirit really exists. I remember going to see, before Katrina, New Orleans was a very, very strong, energetic city, okay? And then when Katrina came along, it completely cleansed the energy. And then it slowly started coming back. So I base my main event every year in New Orleans, the Endless Night Vampire Ball. We are the largest vampire ball in history throughout the world. The Endless Night happens at the House of Blues every Halloween weekend, and we basically create a living vampire mythology that people can walk into and dress up in costume and participate in an experience at a vampire ball. And we've actually almost outgrown the House of Blues, and we sell out every single year. It's incredible. I don't even advertise the event, and I have a great team, and we put a lot of love into creating the event. We want to keep continually making it a more interesting experience. But what's really cool about this is that I spend the rest of the year traveling around the world, giving lectures, and throwing endless nights around the world. We did Prague, Austria, Berlin, London, Barcelona, Paris, Tampa, New York, and now we have one in LA. The next one will be in Los Angeles at the Globe Theater on the 23rd of February, 2018. And the theme is Anti-Valentine's Day. So, my goal is to make Los Angeles the vampire capital of the world. And I think the city has tremendous potential for that, okay? Because there's so much energy here of creative, and basically, you come here to become immortal. That's why a lot of people moved it. You talk to any Uber driver, they're an actor coming into town, or any bartender. So LA is very much a vampire city. So you've got New Orleans, New York, London, Paris, talked about that a little bit with the Theater of the Vampires, and also Los Angeles. So those are the kind of what to me are the iconic vampire places in the world. So you go to these locations and you can really connect with the energy and see a vampire hunting in the streets and the mythology interacting with the personality of that city. So those are that. Now, we're going to go into next, we're going to go into talk about the vampire community as it exists today. I went to a little bit of the history of New York. Okay, we have the kids in Harlem, we have the old school vampires, but the very first organization to consider itself vampiric was a Luciferian coven in Père Lachaise Cemetery in Paris. Okay, they existed for a couple years, they eventually fizzled away. But in 1984, a breakoff of the Church of Satan called the Temple of Set formed a group called the Order of Vampire, Order of the Vampire, which used the vampire archetype and energy to be able to kind of create a vampire energy. Then in 1989, a group called the Temple of the Vampire was the first organization to start a vampire religion. And they still exist today in Lacey, Washington. The 1990s, something really important happened. Has anybody heard of Vampire the Masquerade, the role-playing game or the video game? Can you raise your hand, please? Okay. In the early 1990s, a game of personal horror came out by a gentleman named Mark Reinhagen, published by White Wolf Game Studio, where you got to play a vampire of one of 13 clans of vampires. They had a vampire government, and each city had a prince. And these ideas came from Vampire the Masquerade. They had a law called the Masquerade, where vampires had to basically, if you were not of the blood, you would have to die. Vampires were hiding behind the masquerade. They were in the theater of the vampires, but in the world, in the Camarilla, which was a government, a conspiracy, a vampire Illuminati ruled the world. And what was very cool about it is no humans, no mortals knew that vampires existed. So if I fed from you, and I took your neck and I put it to the side, I could cut you, drink your blood, and then use my blood to heal your wound. And that would be called the Dark Kiss. But Vampire the Masquerade became very popular as a LARP. Has anybody heard the word LARP? Live action role play. And they would play them in nightclubs. And I ran these games in nightclubs in the 90s. And that's how I got into limelight, in the nightclub scene in New York. I had these professional fangs made on by my girlfriend, and I wanted to go to the prom as vampires. And so in 1984, I went to the prom as a vampire. You know, top hat and cane and whatnot. But because of my fangs and because of my role-playing interest, I got into the limelight because the guys that ran the limelight were all playing Dungeons & Dragons while they were counting money and dealing with what club promoters did in the 90s, which was, I guess I can say it now, they were drug dealers. So I remember playing Dungeons & Dragons and Vampire the Masquerade amongst, you know, these people that were giving about these party drugs. And none of the role-players really did it because we got high off our acting. And you'd be able to go to the bar and buy a secret drink and be able to drink it, and that would give you powers and stuff that you could get. You would get like a card from the bartender, you would have to go to the secret bartender. But we had a church at 666 Avenue called Limelight, and we played Vampire the Masquerade. Well, has anybody heard of Underworld? Raise your hand. Has anybody heard of True Blood? Raise your hand. Has anybody heard of Vampires versus Werewolves? That trope. Raise your hand. Seen Twilight? Vampires versus werewolves? Have you seen the movie Underworld? True Blood? Blade? All of these storylines were copies of Vampire the Masquerade. They all came from the mythology of Vampire the Masquerade. And what was most interesting is the vampire community, the vampire culture today, used Vampire the Masquerade as its social structure, with different clans and princes and lords. And today, people are living as vampires. Has anybody seen a vampire on television? A person that goes on a talk show and says, I'm a vampire? Which one have you seen?
Vampire Don.
Vampire Don?
Yeah, he lives in San Diego.
Oh, he's Don.
Straight black hair.
The Vampire Don.
Yeah.
He's disappeared, man. I don't know what happened.
Yeah, I haven't seen him for a while. But for a while, he was out there on everything.
My vampire powers drink a lot of coffee.
That's good.
The Vampire Don. Yes, Don the Vampire was on a TV show called Mad Madhouse. And that show basically was Don had it, man. He could have been king of the vampires, and he just disappeared. I don't know what happened to Don. So let's talk about vampire culture as it is today. Okay. Now there's several different classifications, but there's three main types of people in the vampire culture. There's lifestylers, there's psychic vampires, and then there are blood drinkers. Has anybody here drinking blood? Human blood? What do you guys think of that? Does it turn you on? Does it repulse you? Does it weird you out? Raise your hand if it turns you on. Raise your hand if it repulses you. Raise your hand if it excites you. I can see some people kind of butting their hands up. But the point is that blood is the symbol of life, okay? And in every being, we are animated by life force. And that is what the vampire feeds on. So the sanguine vampire is someone who believes that they need to drink blood to maintain their personal, mental, spiritual, and physical health. They're out of balance if they don't drink human blood. Okay. The second type of vampire, which is the most common, is the psychic vampire, which is energy. Usually, it comes in a whole spectrum of different types. Have you guys ever met someone that just makes you feel like shit? And you can't get rid of them? Okay. I call that an emo vamp.
Oh.
Like, and you, these are the most common types of vampires. You'll meet emo vamps everywhere. Have you met these people that just drain you and make you feel like crap and miserable? A lot of times they're unawakened psychic vampires. The awakening is the understanding of that you become an energy sensitive. You have this need for life force that your body can't generate, the higher level of energy. And an ethical psychic vampire is someone who actually learns how to do it without hurting people. Energetic feeding is a very common thing. Everyone does it subconsciously. Has anybody ever been to a nightclub and felt the energy and pulled it in? Or gone to a sports event and felt the emotional energy, the life force of the teams clashing against each other? That is actually what we call ambient feeding in the psychic vampire realm. Okay. Then there's touch feeding or surface feeding, and then there's deep feeding where you feed into the core of the person's chakras. And the best part is it's not illegal because no one believes it exists scientifically. And when you feed on someone, the vampire usually gets higher and energetic. And what we call the awakening is the realization that you are energetically required to do this, to balance your spiritual, emotional, and physical health. Okay, I realized I had my awakening when I was about 12 years old. I had a dream of every event that would happen between the time I was 12 and the time I was 45. And it all came true. It's really creepy. And including my primary love interest in my life, I didn't even, I saw her when I was 12. I felt her, and when I met her, I knew it was her because of the way I felt. I remembered the feeling from when I was younger. So psychic energy, you can say it's bullshit. But one of the things that I find very interesting is that very few people actually are energy sensitive. Now, you can have empathy, being empathetic. Empathic, is anybody here empathic? Like you feel other people's emotions, you're very good at it. You look like you're an empathic dog.
A little bit.
Really? That is what basically a lot of psychic vampires are, unawakened psychic vampires. They're very empathic. But what they do is they drain you of your energy because they feel you feeling good and they want to connect to that energy. And they're attracted to very positive places. Okay, psychic vampires and traditional psychic vampires or emo vamps will go into self-help groups, they'll go to AA meetings, they'll go anywhere where they can basically take people down or make people feel that they're not as strong in their life force or energy. Okay, so we've got the sanguine vampire, the psychic vampire with the different spectrums, and then there's the lifestyler. The lifestyler basically is someone who likes to dress up as a vampire, okay? A lot of people in the vampire culture, they'll go with these noble titles and they'll dress up in a lifestyle and they'll have all these, you know, a court of vampires, and it's a role play without the role playing game. It's a lifestyle vampire. Now, a lot of them are also psychic vampires and a lot of them are also sang vampires, but it doesn't mean that they are. So if you meet, you know, Don the vampire, was actually a psychic, a sanguine, and a lifestyler, all three, and did all three very well. Okay, He was Welsh and Japanese, and I was born in the same hospital as him, 6 months apart.
That's weird.
Yes. By the same doctor. That's creepy, right?
Yeah.
The synchronicities are very deep. Hey, Autumn, how many people do we have watching?
63 right now.
Oh, that's pretty cool. Is anybody saying anything? Is there a chat happening?
There's some people.
Could you tell me about some of the people?
Katie asks, what are your thoughts on vampires in Hemlock Grove?
Oh, I haven't seen Hemlock Grove. I gotta check that shot out. But let's finish the different tribes of vampires. Then you have the scholars, who are people like J. Gordon Melton, who wrote the vampire book. You have Catherine Ramsden, who was Anne Rice's biographer, who wrote Piercing the Darkness. You have also Rosemary Ellen Guiley, which is writing, she's writing a book with me called Vampire World History about, it's kind of my memoirs of the vampire world. And these guys are basically the scholars of the vampire scene. They watch the vampire subculture and they interact with it. Then you have the role players. And these people play Vampire the Masquerade. It's its own subculture. And a lot of these tribes are blurring together, including the biggest tribe, which is fandom. You know what fandom is? We call this fandom. And there's so many different groups of this. Like, you have Twihards, Twilight fans. You have Anne Rice fans. You have Hemlock fans. You also have a whole variety of different genres and groups and interests. Like, you know, there's some of the lifestylers actually sleep in coffins. It's really funny, because and this was more in the 90s. You meet these girls that dress like Vampira and Elvira, and they actually sleep in coffins, and they drive hearses. And that was very popular in LA in the 80s and 90s. So as the vampire mythology evolves, people incorporate it into their lifestyle. Okay. How many people believe that Harry Potter's real? Well, what was very interesting, I remember going to the Memnon Ball in New Orleans, which was Anne Rice's big event after Interview with the Vampire came out. Anne Rice came down the street in a horse-drawn hearse and was brought out of a coffin and then surprised everybody with Kirsten Dunst, who played Claudia in the movie. And greeted every single guest into an orphanage where this was the most magnificent vampire. I'll never, ever be able to compete against this. They put $500,000 into this event, and there were 6,000 guests. You walked through Anne Rice's doll collection. There was Victorian dancers in one room, violinists in another, a BDSM thing going on in one room. It was insane, and the orphanage was just gigantic. And Anne Rice was sitting there with Kirsten Dunst, greeting every single guest that walked through the door. And after that, I was like, I gotta do a vampire ball. And I went back to New York, and I threw a vampire ball. My goal was to do that vampire ball at Limelight in 1996. That changed my life. So, but what was interesting in New Orleans is there was people there that believed Anne Rice was lying, that Lestat was real. She was like, Lestat's not real. And Anne Rice does not like the lifestyle or vampire community. She sees the vampire as a metaphor of everything that is wrong with the world, or everything that's tragic, okay? You know, Lestat the vampire. Has anybody heard of Lestat the Lion Court? Raise your hand if you heard of Lestat. Good, okay. Because most of you guys, when you think of a vampire today, you know, Dracula, right? Lestat is the modern Dracula. He will be reintroduced to you if Anne Rice gets a TV show, like Game of Thrones, about her Vampire Chronicles novels. Vampire the Masquerade, it looks like it's making a big comeback in a couple years, where you'll be able to understand the mythology of the Camarilla and the Masquerade itself. There's also has anybody heard of the movie Lost Boys? Raise your hand if you heard of Lost Boys.
Did
you guys watch it? Yeah, I made you guys watch it. You made them watch it? What'd you think of Lost Boys? Now you can be honest. Very 80s?
Yeah.
Very Corey Feldman, right? Lost Boys was the movie that introduced me to the vampire genre. And actually, Lost Boys, believe it or not, was actually a reinterpretation of Peter Pan. Did you notice that?
I didn't even know that until you said that.
Lost Boys?
The title. Yeah, obviously.
Yeah, it's given away by the title. And Michael is Peter Pan. David, played by Keith Sutherland, is Peter Pan. And Wendy and all the brothers, it's a reinterpretation of, and it also connects to Jim Morrison. Everybody knows Jim Morrison, right? Okay,
So Michael, the character Michael, is actually supposed to be very reminiscent of Jim Morrison, becoming immortal and becoming a vampire. There's a lot of symbolism in that movie. So when we look at vampire cinema, there's different categories. There's the old school Dracula movies, the Hammer horror movies. There's also one, there's, I put a vampire list of 10 top vampire movies that you can see on my YouTube channel, Father Sebastian, and I go backwards through them. But some of the top vampire movies, let's see if you guys have seen them. You've seen Lost Boys, raise your hand. Seen Interview with the Vampire. Okay, Bram Stoker's Dracula. That's the most. That was a masterpiece before CGI came out. I love that movie as well. Who has seen What We Do in the Shadows? That's a great, that's my favorite vampire movie, by the way. And it's really funny because some of the people in the vampire community take it really seriously. How can you watch that movie? It's so embarrassing. I can't believe you watched that movie. But you know what? I've watched it probably 30 times and laugh my ass off because it mocks and mimics the vampire genre so well. Like Peter the Nosferatu in the basement, or Vlad. It shows us that the vampire mythology can be a comedy. It can, and Lost Boys was a comedy and a serious movie at the same time. Has anybody seen the movie? Was in Underworld, of course. Rich, I've seen Underworld. Have you seen Vampire in Brooklyn? I know you would say. Have you seen Only Lovers Left Alive?
Do you like that movie?
I love that movie. It's very reminiscent of another movie called The Hunger with David Bowie. Okay, and that was a really, that introduced the bladed ankh. So if you look at cinema has created a vampire mythology that's consistent. What is the most common thing you think about vampires when you think of the vampire mythology?
Blood.
Okay, immortality, beauty, romance, magic, sensuality, graves and coffins, fire, and of course, being able to never have to go to heaven or hell. The vampire is a creature in purgatory. It's a place between worlds. So if you look at the vampire, modern vampire mythology, it's expressed in all these vampire movies that we just went over. And it is one of the most diverse mythologies in history. When you have ghosts, you know, you got a dead person floating around, anchored to a location, and you go and investigate it, you got a couple demons here or there. The vampire mythology is unique because it can be amorphic. It can be anything. You can have an alien vampire. There's a really great movie called Life Force, okay, that came out in 1984. And it was about a space shuttle going up and investigating Halley's Comet. Okay, and they encountered a vampire race of beings in a spaceship that looked like giant bats, and their life force went into a human and possessed a human, and she became the queen of the vampires. Okay, so that's science fiction vampires. Then you have Bram Stoker's Dracula, where you're cursed by God. You have Lost Boys, where there's no origin story, but they're monsters. Okay, but they're rock and roll 80s guys. You've got Underworld, where there's no history of the vampire. I haven't seen in Underworld a vampire feed. They just have blood banks. So, in True Blood, you've got everything. And True Blood brought in a comedy aspect, okay? You know, where they were like, what kind of name is Bill for a vampire? So when we look at the vampire movie genre, it's extremely important to look at the diversity of what is offered. So vampire fandom will pay attention to these different genres and look at the different types of vampire films that exist. And when you look at the vampire cinema, it is really a reflection of what we want to be, but what we also don't want to become. The vampire is an anti-hero, but before it was a monster. For example, if you had red hair and you lived in Romania, when you died, you'd become a vampire. That was a symbol. Or a dampiri. Anybody redhead here? One. No gingers? So those are basically, we went over mythology, the modern vampire culture, the history of the vampire. We went over the legends. Yes?
You were talking about sanguine vampires a little bit. Is there a stigma to being a sanguine vampire versus a side vampire?
Originally, there was a stigma against psychic vampires in the vampire community, but it's always been a taboo subject because blood drinking. You want me to talk about blood drinking?
Yeah.
Okay. What is, blood drinking is the most intimate thing you can do with another person. Okay. Now, in the vampire culture, we have two types of energy exchange that are the primary foundations. Okay. There's feeding or gathering energy from other people, like what I talked about, going to a nightclub or a thing that's a basically the most basic that almost everybody does. Every being exchanges energy, but a vampire takes life force from other people. Surface feeding is basically above the skin, that's massages, handshakes, any physical contact. It can create an energy link that you can pull, like a voodoo doll, having the energy in it, you know, the hair or something. Then there's deep feeding, which is going to the core of the person. Blood drinking is always a deep feed because you're drinking the person's actual physical matter. Okay. It is a high. It tastes very irony. I tried it a couple times, but I found it to be inefficient because, I don't really want to get hepatitis C or HIV or syphilis. But if you most sanguine vampires actually feed psychically most of the time and then do what we call a communion, which is probably one of the greatest things vampires do. A communion is an exchange of energy. And what will happen is once you're energy sensitive, because if I feed from someone who's not awakened, I will take their energy. But I need another awakened vampire to take my energy at the same time, and it cycles the energy around, and it basically amplifies the energy together. Okay, that is often done by holding hands. You can do it in a group setting. You can do it in a setting where there's like a ritual where you want to raise energy. It is an exchange because you're feeding off each other, and it creates like a vacuum, a cycling, like one of those gravitrons. Now, most people who, like, when you drink someone's blood and you have that person in you, that's more intimate than sex. It is very much a tantric thing. And when I make a communion, it's like, what blood brothers are? Okay? You're actually creating an energy connection with that person that is, when you exchange blood, is so deep that it can hardly be broken. You could hear that person's thoughts if you do it enough. The more you do it, the more you commune with that person. Okay? And in Japanese mythology, there's a symbol of what was called the red strings. Okay, where you're born with that energetic connection. And I've been blessed with being able to feel that energetic connection with one person in my life, and it really is a pain in the ass. Okay? But when you do communion, you're basically exchanging energy and building it up and weaving these energetic links with that person, okay, versus feeding where you cut the link and you're just taking life force. And those are the two foundations of vampirism, which is communion and feeding. And it's very interesting to watch because a lot of people don't believe energy exchange happens. I mean, we're exchanging energy right now by looking at each other and talking and communicating and, you paying attention or not paying attention or hanging out or... communion is okay.
Communion sounds fascinating to me. The terms I've heard before were if someone is giving their energy, they call themselves donors. Do you not?
I prefer the word sources.
Sources.
Now, donors was a word that I came up. A couple of the words that I brought into the vampire community was the word household. Mm-hmm. Okay, because I wanted to find an alternative to the word clan. I got that from the Society for Creative Anachronism. That was an alternative to the word coven. Because a lot of the vampire community is pagan. Okay, even though vampirism isn't generally a religion, because it's about energy exchange. It's about the need for life force or lifestyle. Okay. However, donors are people that have a high level of energy or want to give blood. And I remember there used to be blood bars in the 90s. Okay, people that just get off on being fed on by people who want to be vampires.
Why would you want to do that?
Why do people want to dress as puppies? Okay, why do people want to watch? Why do women want to be seduced? Okay, remember the one thing about the vampire mythology that you have to be aware of. It's predatory and it's a rape fantasy. Okay, the donor is the victim. The donor is the concept of a donor is to give that energy willingly, and that's usually with a deep feed. I can go into a nightclub and feed off 1,000 people at the same time. You can't do that with blood. Blood is always a deep feed. But you have to be aware that drinking blood is freaking dangerous. Okay? And, you know, HIV can be a contagious and in the blood for up to 10 years. Okay? You got to deal with syphilis. Yay. There goes Al Capone. Go down like Al Capone. You can also deal with hepatitis C, which sucks. And there's also a whole host of diseases that people don't test for. And most people who are in the vampire community get their blood test every 2 months if they're actively sanguine. And they're dealing with multiple partners. Okay? And the donors always get tested. However, this is not as common as it was in the past because psychic vampirism is an alternative. Okay, more and more people are psychic. Most people that drink blood that you've seen on TV are just doing it to go on TV. Okay? The people that I know that are real sanguine vampires are really not that showman. They do it because it's very important to them and it's very sacred. And I've done the sanguine feeding a couple times. And for me, I make too deep of a connection to that person. And I don't want to have that deep connection. That kind of communion is almost irreversible. And especially in exchange. So it's very much tantric. And for example, in India, there's a form of tantra called the Dharavanchi. And they are sacred prostitutes. Have you heard of them? Okay. I met a Dharavanchi once, and they make an energy called the elixir, which is basically this mixture of body fluids, and it is used for as the elixir of immortality. People drink it. Well, I haven't tried it myself, but I met a Dharavanchi priestess, and she was, like 25, and she had a patron, and a Raja patron and stuff. So drinking blood is very dangerous, but it's really, really kinky, okay? Most people that I know that drink blood have a blood fetish. A lot of people think it's something from post-traumatic stress disorder, okay, why you drink blood. But I do it, when I do it, it's extremely sacred. For years, I was abstinent from blood, okay, because I thought of its dangers and its things, and it takes a very special person. Now, for feeding purposes, it's extremely dangerous. Okay, so you want to have your partner tested, you want to make sure that they're clean, and you also put them through a 6-month quarantine before you do anything. You can wear a condom for sex, but for blood exchange, that's a little bit more risky. Okay, so what I'm going to do is let you guys open the floor to any questions for some of this.
Are you feeding on us right now, energetically?
I'm always feeding. So are you.
So no. On each other?
The biosphere of Earth is an exchange of energy called the Krebs cycle. Okay, and that's an exchange of energy.
So, but exchange, is it different from feeding?
Well, feeding, like for example, the sunlight hits the ground gets fertile, gets energy, the plants grow out, the animals eat the plants, other animals eat them, and then humans eat the animals. Okay, so a one-way feed, yes, I'm feeding all the time. Okay. A lot of unconscious psychic vampires, unawakened psychic vampires, are feeding all the time. That's why they don't have control of what they're doing. They feed on the emotions. I don't feed on emotions. I just feed on excess energy that's a cloud above you, and I do it ambiently. So it's not an invasion of anybody's personal space. It's just a city usually has a halo of life force above it because there's excess energy. It's radiated very much like heat off your body. So if I was to do a deep feed on someone, I would take their core energy, and I wouldn't want to do that unless I knew them.
Why?
Because it's very private. It's very personal. I can do a deep feed without drinking blood, and that's basically kind of like Reiki. So when I'm feeding all the time, I have to keep my energy up, and I can consciously feed, but I'm usually subconsciously ambiently feeding. That's actually why so many vampires are attracted to cities. So much extra life force that's radiated out.
Does that mean that it's hard to be an introverted vampire?
Most vampires are introverted. There's no problem with that. Because they don't have to interact socially to feed. Okay? And I know plenty of vampires that are introverts. Is that your question? Okay. Any other questions? That's a good one. I love garlic. I
get garlic pizza all the time. Garlic mythologically came from a basically it was a cleansing herb, and it would basically be used to get rid of disease. And vampires were very symbolic of disease, because as we talked about earlier, the vampire was a virus, and today it's a romantic antihero. And you can see the evolution of the mythology from there. Garlic was one of the things that would affect the viruses. It was used as a cleansing agent, so that was why it was used in vampire mythology to kind of scare vampires. Any other questions?
I want to hear about vampire fashion.
Vampire fashion. Just look at Alexander McQueen and you're good to go.
Okay.
Let's talk about colors. Why do vampires wear black? Because black is a symbol of mystery. Black is a symbol of, it basically is the absence of light, and it draws light to it like a black hole. Therefore, when a vampire wears black, they're mysterious. They're also, if you look at, they're powerful. It's a power color. Okay, if you look at police, or you look at judges, or you look at corporate executives, they wear a black, when you see a man in a black on black suit, or a woman in a black dress, there's a certain level of power to that. So that's important. Red represents love and romance and also kind of aggression of sorts. Okay, white represents purity and innocence. Purple represents nobility. Okay, but blood is also purple in the body before it gets oxygenated. And when it comes out, it's red. So those are the primary vampire colors.
Today, do you find, like, at your balls and stuff, that they dress sort of goth or more BDSM?
The vampire fashion comes in what we call motifs. You have steampunk vampires, Baroque vampires, Neo-Victorian vampires, modern vampires, cyber fangs, raver vamps. You have the old school motifs of the beautiful dresses. Okay. You have Neo-Victorian vampires, you have Edwardian vampires. The vampire mythology is a time traveler, so he can pick up any motif he wants. Okay. But I think Alexander McQueen represents the vampire. What I would think of a vampire Elysium, like a place where you go and you see vampires hanging out in like an Illuminati type situation, or all black. Like, I don't wear anything but black and purple and red, unless I go see my family. My family thinks that it's really cool. Okay, I was just hunting with my cousin. We went deer hunting the other day, and we were sitting there, and he was like, "You're the coolest cousin I got," and I'm like, "Thanks, man." My parents aren't super religious. My family's, you know, half very conservative. And look, I'm traveling the world. I make a good living. I meet amazing people. I live in Hollywood. Okay, I got to live in Paris. And I'm making a living, paying my taxes like everyone else, and I'm not breaking the law, and I'm not forming a cult, okay, where I brainwash little people and tell them that they're really vampires. I make vampire teeth and throw parties, okay, and love the mythology. But the reality is, I think that it was hard at first. My dad thought I was really weird because he wanted me to play like a football player, okay. But as I developed my personality of Father Sebastian, and interacted, I like to say that I'm the father of the vampire world. That's kind of like my claim to fame in the world. But I'm doing what I love. And my father and my mom told me, do what you love and the success will come. And that's what I based my whole life on, is that motto that my dad told me when I was 13, do what you're passionate about. And I found a passion and I went with it. So they're pretty cool about it. My grandmother thought I was Looney Tunes. And when I wanted my grandfather, who was a dentist, to make me fangs, he thought I was crazy.
Did he make you fangs?
No. But my grandfather's a dentist and my aunt's a dentist. Okay, so there's dental. I became a dental technician. I worked for a prosthodontist for 18 months to be able to learn how to do what I do. Now I started a new company called Legacy Fangs, and we're 3D printing vampire teeth. You get a scan of your mouth, and it's a luxury product. And we're taking the Endless Night Vampire Ball and bringing it to the next level as an immersive theater. We're going to have actors going around playing different characters in the party. So from 8 to midnight at the event, or 9 to midnight, you know, Vlad Dracula might come up to you and give you a quest. Okay, and it's a game. Because we want to do it before midnight, before everybody gets too drunk.
Do people ever raise their kids in a vampire?
Yeah, I actually was in Berlin, and my roommate was what's really interesting is I get to name a lot of people. When I make fangs, I give them a vampire name out of a book of mythology, and a lot of people want me to name them. And I've had about 500 people change the legal names to the names that I give. Okay, I have hundreds of godchildren who are people that met through my fang business. Okay, and these kids, you know what's cool about vampires versus goth or some other alternative lifestyle is that vampires can be a normal person during the day, and you have your night side and your day side, and these different paradigms. I have a friend who's a kitten. Her name is Kitty Pendleton, and she lives in Manchester, England, and she's a cat. The girl's a freaking cat, okay? And she teaches, and that's a fetish. And she teaches grammar school with cat ears. And it's the same thing goes with the vampire, okay? You'll meet someone and never even know they're a vampire. They could be your Uber driver, okay? They could be your mailman. They could be the bartender behind the bar, or they could be a corporate exec. But I knew two psychic vampires and one sanguine that are in the European Parliament. And being out of the coffin is one thing. Being in the coffin, that's why a lot of our events have masks. Like, you know, when MySpace was around, you could have a fake name. Today you can't. Okay? So you're pretty much exposed. Privacy is being eroded from our world. Okay? You know, as Gen Xers go, oh yeah, I'm going to have the pseudonym and I'm going to be Xanatos or this or that. And then when Facebook went through, nope, we want you to be advertising money, because basically any free service you have online, you're the product, you're not the customer. Okay? What happened was the whole vampire scene went through what the drag queen community went through, where all their personal name, I mean, I was like, you know, my grandmother gave me the name Sebastian. I was born as Aaron, okay? And my grandmother wanted me to have a saint's name, to have the Catholic tradition. Okay, and Aaron was the Hebrew name, that's what I grew up with. But since I was 12, I was called Sebastian by almost everybody I know, okay? And that's who I became. I got to choose my saint. So my grandmother put this big book out and said, choose your saint, and I loved archery. So that's where I got the name Sebastian from. And one of the things that is really amazing about the vampire mythology is it's a lifestyle, so you can create yourself. You can build who you are. And, you know, when you're about taking, like, not all lifestyle of vampires are psychic vampires. And it's okay. I mean, a lot of people, like, you know, they feel that they're not an energy feeder for some reason, that there's some, like, bad person being a lifestyle vampire. I know plenty of them. They're fun. It's awesome.
Do you get psychic benefits from it, in other words, longer life, or, you know, more charisma, or anything?
No. I think you can, if you feed enough and learn how to use that with willpower, you can use energy sensitivity for anything. Okay? When I don't have, like, a huge energy deficiency, but I have a need for life force. Okay? When I feed on life force, I feel better, I feel happier, I'm run further, jump higher, like a Nike shoe. Is it a placebo? I don't know, but it works, and that's what's important to me. Any other questions? I like you. You have good questions. What's your question?
Why do people relate vampires to bats?
To bats?
Yeah.
There's a lot of symbolism. My clan of vampires, Sabretooth, is more attuned to a feline. We're the great cats. Our shapeshifts are not, our symbolic animal is not, our totem animal is the saber-toothed tiger, okay, like the La Brea tar pits. And it's very American. And Sabretooth is the largest clan of vampires in the world. We have thousands of members throughout the world and a very interactive community. We even have our own castle in Austria. Timeshare, but it's a castle. And the Sabretooth clan is very unique. All right, because we're feline, okay? Bat and wolf symbolism, I really believe, came in because there's vampire bats, okay? And Dracula really reinforced that. And bats are very symbolic of what a vampire represents. They fly through the night and they feed on blood, because there are vampire bats that actually drink cow blood. Does that answer your question? Any others? You guys are asking good questions.
In terms of,
Okay. I encourage you all to see the World of Darkness documentary that will talk about Vampire the Masquerade. It's coming out next spring. It's currently going through the film festival circuit. Okay? It's a World of Darkness documentary. And they go through the vampire versus werewolf mythology. Originally was if you were a werewolf in life, you'd become a vampire in death. Okay? When Vampire the Masquerade came out, it has Vampire the Masquerade has five different stories. There's Vampire the Masquerade, Werewolf the Apocalypse, Mage the Ascension, Changeling the Dreaming, and Wraith the Oblivion. And all of these are kind of like, you know how you have different Marvel characters and there's a shared universe? Well, in the World of Darkness is a shared universe between all these different stories of, you know, like the perspective of the vampire, the perspective of the werewolf. Werewolves in Vampire the Masquerade, which came out in the early 90s, were warriors of Gaia. It wasn't a curse. There was 13 tribes of werewolves, and their mission was to kill the vampires. Okay? So what you see in Underworld, there was a lawsuit between White Wolf, the company that publishes Vampire the Masquerade, and I believe Universal, and they sued for when they created Underworld, and they won. Because it was a ripoff of Vampire the Masquerade. It was too close to the storyline. I think it was done prior. I don't know the whole story behind that, but it's really interesting to see Underworld is... Really, like the vampires in Underworld are the Camarilla vampires from Vampire the Masquerade. You know, very beautiful and classy and really cool iconic imagery. The role players, LARPers, and White Wolf Game Studio, or now White Wolf Entertainment, and Vampire the Masquerade has, I think, brought all the vampire mythologies together and tied them together and interacted with different mythologies. So, Vampires vs. Werewolves is an invention of Vampire the Masquerade. Before that, vampires and werewolves were just kind of myths that didn't really interact other than Dracula turning. Dracula was not a werewolf. He could shapeshift into a wolf. He could command wolves because they were creatures of the night. What sweet music they make. You know that old line? And so the werewolf, there are people, they call themselves Therians, who have the totem of a wolf. And I swear that these people have a wolf soul, okay? But what's really interesting is they more feel like Hugh Jackman's Wolverine, okay, in the way that you interact with them. Because in the gay community, do you know what an otter is? Okay, an otter's a very tall, skinny guy with long hair. You know what a bear is in the gay community? Okay, I can't believe when we were kids we couldn't talk about this
thing. Yeah.
All right, and then there's wolves, which basically huge, you know, very sleek, muscular, thin, tall guys with chops and stuff like that. And these, they energetically represent something very wolf-like in your soul. I had a guy named Joseph, who was kind of my werewolf brother. He was always wearing a leather jacket. He reminded me a lot of Hugh Jackman's Wolverine, way before that happened. And he had, you know, nice, he was almost angelic, but he was like, I'm a wolf, dude. I'm not a vampire. And I meet people like that, and they call themselves Therians. And I swear, man, sometimes when they get in a certain mood, they can't turn into a wolf, but they, you get that wolf energy off. And there's another guy in New York who can howl. Like, he's really famous for howling. And when you hear the word lupine, okay, or what do they call them in Underworld? Lycans. That came from... A lot of people in the vampire community use the word lichen, but lupine, loup-garou, means werewolf in French. Okay, so lichen is basically from lycos, which was an ancient king in Greece that could shapeshift into, and that's where lycanthropy comes from, which is the curse of the wolf spirit inside you. You can shapeshift into a wolf. And what's cool about Werewolf the Apocalypse, the game, the mythology, has three different types of werewolves. One, werewolves that are born as wolves, werewolves that are born as humans, and then werewolves are not allowed to breed with each other because it's going to damage the bloodline. And that offspring is usually sterile. So, you know, werewolves have to, I think they're called auspices. I can't remember exactly the term in the game. But if you want to look at a really cool vampire werewolf mythology, check out Werewolf the Apocalypse. It's a great game.
I think we used up Sebastian's time. So I want to say thanks to you guys for coming, and thank you to Father Sebastian for coming.
lot of stuff to cover, and I thank you for all sending to. How long were we? Are we over?
Well, you know, we could probably talk for another 3 hours, but.
Sure. I'm open for a couple more questions if anybody has anything else. If not, okay, great. That is true. The process of fang making, the art is called fang smithing, okay, like metal smithing or blacksmithing. I learned from a dentist. I mean, I've seen people make fangs, but I actually sat down for 18 months carving dentures and cleaning dentures and working for a prosthodontist every Wednesday while I was in college. It sucked. It smelled bad too, you know, old dentures.
Oh.
And then my mom was the first person I made fangs for. So basically I do what, there's different variations on it. There's ones with pre-made teeth, there's ones with dentures. There's West Coast fang smithing and East Coast fang smithing. Like East Coast is basically freehand where you take a wad of acrylic and you put it in a ball and you shape it on the teeth and let it dry. West Coast, you make an impression, I have a retainer. But basically everybody has gone to the East Coast style of fang smithing, which is a pre-made tooth that you reline with dental resin. You put it on the tooth, it dries, and then you shave it down with a Dremel tool and polish it. And I probably made several thousand pairs. And I get to meet each person in person. Now with the 3D printing, basically I'm getting ready to kind of like go to the next phase of my life where I want to settle down and maybe get married and have, you know, baby vampires, okay? Which will, you know, the vampire philosophy of raising children I'll talk to you about in a minute. But what is interesting is fang smithing does four major things. First, it changed my life because I was very shy, believe it or not, as a child. Okay, I was social, but I was very introverted. And I am an introvert, but when I make fangs, I'm at my best because that person has to be submissive to me. And I feel that there's an exchange. When I make fangs, like I've met every single girlfriend I've ever had for making fangs. Okay, it's a great way to pick chicks up. All right, I'm not kidding. It's like being a DJ or in a band or something like that. Because you have an intimate contact with that person. You're touching that person. So there's a comfort zone that's built. It's done professionally. Like I don't ever hit on a girl while I'm making fangs, but if they call me later, I'm not gonna say no. But like anything, men are always trying to impress women. Okay, that's the thing. And fangs are very cool because they're a social tool. They're a way of interacting. When you go to a bar and see someone wearing fangs, you go, you know, it's a conversation breaker. It's a mask. And has anybody, like, understood the psychology of wearing a mask? Okay, when you wear a mask, you put it on, a lot of your inhibitions go away because people can't identify you. Okay? And a lot of people put personas on over them. Like, I'm who I am. I'm Sebastian. Hi. Okay? But when it comes to the core of who you are, a mask lets those inhibitions go away. Another thing is they're a magic trick. The fangs look so real that when you look at, you can go up to my gum line and examine them and they'll look real, even if you look up really close, okay? The next thing is they're an incredible sex toy. Everybody wants to know what it's like to kiss or do other things with the fangs on, okay? You know, I always get couples that come in and one girl gets the fangs and then the husband comes in 2 weeks later with a scarf around his neck and he's like, I need to defend myself. And he got fangs because his girlfriend keeps biting him, or his wife keeps biting him. They're not good for breaking the skin because human saliva is dirtier than dog saliva. Not a good idea. You can take them off, so they're like a temporary body mod that's almost real. They're a great conversation starter, and they're also very, very sexy. And they bring out your primal energy. It brings out your animalistic side. So you kind of like, you know, when you're playing around, you can, it's a slight role play. And I've been wearing fangs the whole interview, the whole lecture, and I can speak fine. But what's really funny is when someone gets their fangs for the first time, for about 6 months, they have that like tongue-piercing lift. And they're like, I'm a baby flipping vampire. And it cracks me up because it's just freaking funny to watch people. You know, not everybody has a bliss, but sometimes the elder vampires, it's usually an elder vampire who's 5 or more years in the community, active. And when I make fangs after 5 years, someone becomes an elder in the Sabertooth clan. There's different term
ways of becoming an elder. I have stone colors in the young. So after 1 year, you get a red stone. After 5 years, a purple stone. 13 years, a black stone. But it's really funny watching people slur with the fangs on. And sometimes elder vampires who've had them for 5, 10 years still have a lisp. So you call them a fledgling elder. It's a lot of fun.
Might be in LA for a long time.
I'm going to tell you this. The crew, the team that puts Endless Night together is a family. Okay, we're a very, very tight group of people. And we have different teams around the world, but there's a core culture to it. Okay, and they're all Sabretooth members. All the people that work for Endless Night, the core team. Endless Night, I've dreamed of doing one in LA, but I waited 20 years to do it. And we did it last year, and we had about 1,000 people. It's a lot of fun. The energy's really good. I love Endless Night because there's no drugs. I mean, of course, people probably do them outside the club, but you don't see, it's not like raves where you see people snorting, you know, pockets of KHB or, you know, or doing all this stuff. It's a very low drug community. People smoke a little weed, that's legal. We have a traditional drink called a bloodbath. At midnight, we have a cirque, so you can see, like, for example, in New Orleans, you'll see the live show on the main stage. Which is basically a whole theatrical piece with opera singers and belly dancers and a costume contest. And Endless Night's interesting because we don't have to do a lot because the audience is the performer. The dress code itself is the performance, and we celebrate that. The costumes are wonderful. We do a red carpet here in LA because each Endless Night chapter has its own kind of thing. Like New Orleans is one thing, which is very voodoo. LA is very Hollywood. New York is very rock and roll New York. Paris is very elegant and classy. Okay, Tampa is very Tampa. And one of our largest Endless Nights is in Tampa, Florida. Believe it or not, Florida. I don't know how that happened. We get like 1,000 people every time. And but New Orleans is the centrifuge. And my passion for New Orleans is so strong because I've been in New Orleans for every Halloween since 1995. I fell in love with New Orleans. And I can't be anywhere else for Halloween. I just can't do it. When Katrina came, we had to do 2 years in New York, and it broke my freaking heart. I mean, like, I'm the local New Orleans vampire community has many different factions, but one of them came up to me and said, "Father Sebastian, do you realize you're a local?" And I'm like, "I'm only here 1 week a year. You go around the world bringing people to New Orleans. Every event you do is a pre-party for this, to bring people here to New Orleans to celebrate and enjoy the French Quarter and enjoy this beautiful city." So, Endless Night, LA, yes, it's going to be, because it's part of a circuit. On Halloween night, I'm announcing a new location. And we're going to have a very, very interesting vampire ball weekend. And remember, they're immersive theaters. So you don't have to be a Sabretooth to enter the party. Okay? You can come to an Endless Night as a black swan, which means that you don't have fangs or you're not officially a vampire, but you want to come and dress up and have a good time. We're a costume event. And it's really beautiful to see how creative people get. And how, also, it's a very safe environment for women. Okay, one of the things that I really pride myself on is, you know, immortality is something that I'm looking for as legacy. I want to be immortal and I want to take people on this legacy, which is the story that I've created in life. All these vampires in the world are part of my legacy. Okay, so it's really interesting to see how now I'm going to work with White Wolf after 20 years. I finally get to work with the Dream Company and help them out. I can't talk about what I'm doing, but they might be moving to LA, opening office, let's pray. And I become very close with the guys that are running the new edition of White Wolf, who made Vampire the Masquerade, and I started with that. That was like my beginnings. And what is really beautiful about the vampire culture is the reason why I don't call myself King of the Vampires, okay, or the God of the Vampires, or Lord Sebastian, is because being a father, kids grow up, and I don't have to be responsible for them after they get to a certain point in their vampiric evolution, okay? Being a father is something, you know, I want on my gravestone, this is the best vampire father ever, and I think it's a more humble and more powerful title that I can really represent myself, because basically, I went into the vampire community and there wasn't anything except the role playing. When I started, there was nothing there in regards to culture with music and art and traditions. So I wrote the Black Veils to be able to do that. I want to see what is vampire music? What is vampire sports? Vampires play sports? We at our castle, we have a conclave event every 2 years in this castle called Burg Finstergrund, and it's run by the Evangelical Lutheran Church of Austria, and they love us. Okay, they welcome us with open arms. I've made fangs for Catholic priests, okay, who are Sabretooth members and go to Sabretooth events. Catholic priests. I met one Catholic priest at a fetish party in Nancy, France, and I made his fangs. And the next day, I didn't believe it was a priest. He came and picked me and my friend up, and we drove down to the church on Palm Sunday, and that goddamn motherfucker's doing a whole mass. And I'm like, can I do the communion? And I'm wearing my fangs, and I'm like, you can wear your fangs in communion during mass? He's like, no, it's pushing it. I'll wear my fangs for the brunch afterwards. I'm like, you can't eat with them. I'm like, okay. So I went with him to his church, and he freaking walks out. The guy ran a mass in the middle of France. And I'm like, I just made that guy fangs. Oh my God, he's a vampire. And so I asked if I could do communion. I was baptized Presbyterian, which is Church of England, which is Catholic light. He said, are you Church of England? I said, yeah. And he goes, okay, you can qualify. And I came up, and he takes the wafer, and he looks me in the eye, and he goes, may the force be with you, in a Catholic mass. And I'm like, this is the coolest priest I've ever met. That is having, like, one of the things about saber-tooth culture, not the vampire culture, the saber-tooth culture, the endless night culture, which is the core of the vampire community, the VC, and has influenced a lot. Women are comfortable and safe to be sexy, and my clients are female. Okay. There's very little drugs or drug abuse. Okay. There's a lot of empowerment and support. There's a lot of love, and there's a strong family vibe that the Sabretooth clan takes care of each other. Okay. And the only way to become a Sabretooth is for me personally to make your fangs until the 3D fangs become more available. There'll be old clan Sabretooth, who are the people I made fangs for personally, and new clan Sabretooth, which will be the 3D printed fangs. So, and we've also adopted 250 kitten girls. That's another story.
Did you want to show your slides?
Yeah, let's do some slides. We got some visuals for you. The lights were. Everybody enjoying the lecture? You learning anything? Oh, here we go. I can probably tell you each person in these pictures. Okay, so here we have the donor, or the victim, is Isabella. She's from Colorado, and the other girl is Bella, the huntress. And how do we move these through the screen? Okay. So here's the legacy Ankh and three different variations. The one on the left is made by Elegant Curiosities in the Netherlands. The one in the middle is made by Alchemy Gothic, and the one on the right is made as a gift that I give to every fang client that I make fangs for. The legacy Ankh represents the story of all the people I made fangs for, a collective storyline. This is Bridget. She's from the Czech Republic, and that is her donor in a nightclub in London called Nuit Demonia. And this picture is by another vampire named Hannibal, and that's his real name. And Hannibal's from Hungary. So this is in Paris, and she's one of my fang clients that I see every year because she wants a new parrot every year. This is Tessa, or La Duchessa. She is a black swan vampire, which means she's not an energy vampire or a sanguine. She's more of a lifestyler. But she's a really famous cosplayer from London, from the Netherlands. She's Dutch, and she's really cool, and she's a hardcore steampunk. I can't remember who this is, but this is, has anybody seen the picture of the fangs that say, on the meme that's black and white that says, bad things? That was a famous picture that went viral. Some of my fangs went viral, it was really cool. This is my clan at the conclave in in Austria, in our castle called Burg Finstergrund, owned by the Lutheran Church. We rent it every year. We did it every year for 3 years, but it became too much to get out to the middle of the Alps. These are about 30 people from 14 countries that I make fangs, and none of them knew each other before they got to the event. And we were there for a week.
This is a young lady from the Ukraine. I cannot remember her name off the top of my head, but she's a Vampire the Masquerade player. She's really sweet, very cool cosplayer. There's Bridget again. There's Tessa. That's a picture I just thought was cool. This is Misty Dawn. She's from Los Angeles. And a lot of, as you can see, most of my clients, it's not Facebook. most of my clients are women. All right. Can you put your hand in front of the screen? Because I don't want to get this thing from Facebook. Okay. Next. Okay, let go. This is Black Veils. This is the book that's coming out in next spring. This has 140 words of power, like romance and sexuality, magic and all this stuff, that actually give you a vampire philosophy that all weave together. Are basically, they started as some events in my nightclub. That Black Veils was kind of like inspired from The Masquerade, from Vampire the Masquerade, but a real world version. And the original five Black Veils were 18 to enter, 21 to feed, don't drink blood in the club, dress really cool and look nice, okay, don't be an asshole, basically be ladies and gentlemen, and what happens in the club stays in the club. Those evolved into the rest of the Black Veils, and this is the cover for the next edition. And there's me as a rock star vampire by Chad Michael Ward. And this is the Los Angeles Vampire Ball. This model is incredible. Her name is Morgana, and she's from Spain, Galicia, Spain, but she lives in London. And what's interesting about it is I have a group of women called the Muses, and these Muses are women that I put on my flyers. I always use pictures of women. We might have a male muse coming up, but what's interesting about her is, other than the fangs and the costuming, the clothing is from Royal Black in Austria, which is an incredible company. She did the photography and the Photoshop and did everything and designed the flyer. So she did everything by herself. And then just like 2 days later, I had the photo shoot. This is the masked party hosted by the Chateau. So Sabretooth Clan is the big cats. Remember I talked about adopting kittens? My counterpart, Isabella, is the queen of the kittens. And she has a BDSM organization called the Chateau, Cat Chat. And she's hosting our Temple of Bast in New Orleans, which is an event in New Orleans that is our VIP party after the Vampire Ball. Here's me on stage at the Dallas Endless Night, and we're doing the costume contest. And what I do is, like I told you, I travel around the world, and I collect people to bring them to New Orleans. And so the winners of each costume contest for each Endless Night that we go around the world get two VIP tickets in the world. So it's an incentive to go down. And I think we're done. So there's, I don't want to get back to Misty. But so that's
It's okay, I'll turn
on. Okay, thank you. So that's kind of a little glimpse of into the vampire world, as I like to call it, or vampire community. And I want to thank you guys. You've been a really good audience. And I want to give you guys a round of applause.
All right. Thank you. We so appreciate it. You guys mind you're off? Go away for 25 minutes. And you are excused. Thank you so much for coming.
Okay, thank you for being, I think that's my call.